So what do you need to know before actually starting drawing your own value chain map? Well, very important is to know your boundaries. So what is the commodity? What is the location? And what are the market boundaries? And think of the distance to the end consumer or the different market segments and the product diversity. How many products can you get out of one crop, for example? And also reflect on the important questions to ask. And therefore, there is a document that we have shared and that you can download from our website, Enough for Ag Pacific. And it will guide you in detail through the different steps and the questions. So we're not going into very detail how to do it, but the document itself will guide you step by step through it so that it is easy for you to do your own value chain map. And before you draw, there's quite some really important questions to ask. So who are the actors and where's the product sold? Like we have given some examples before, is it at farm level or in the city or on the world market? And to whom do farmers sell? And is the product then stored, graded, processed? What value-adding activities are done and by whom? And into what different products can the product itself be processed? And who is doing that? And who is selling to whom? And what are the prices that are being paid at the different levels of the value chain? And the value chain mapping is done in four steps. So the actors start always with the farmer and then identify value adding activities for each actor, put the prices that you know on the map, and show as best as you can the distribution of the total productivity quantity from different producers to different market segments.
I'm taking up from what Jana just told you. She just explained you that we take four steps, we suggest you four steps to develop your value chains. And the first one is to list your different actors. I just made an example with you, for you with Ted, where we have a case of tomato production at national level, aiming at national markets, from the east of Turkey. I have actors, my two actors at the beginning of the chain from the production side is the medium scale farmers and the small scale farmers. I have the information that 55% of the tomato, which is totally 9,000 tons, 55% come from small-scale farmers and 45% from medium-scale farmers. The other actors that I first identified were the traders, the supermarket warehouse that also buys directly from the farmers, the wholesalers, the supermarkets, the open market, retailers, and then I had the three different consumer segments for my case, which are the high-income consumers, the middle-income consumers and non-income consumers. Once I identified the actors, I try to identify the value-adding activities that they undertake. So it was all before doing all these lines. I try to understand, okay, the traders buys directly 100% of the tomato that is produced from the small-scale farmers, and then he sells 45% to the wholesalers and 35% of that produce to the retailers. While he does that, he has a kind of grading, he has a transporting as a value-adding activity. The supermarket, who buys 20% of the medium-scale farmers, for instance, sorts 75% of his of the tomatoes he buys, or they buy, they sort them and package them to different grades and sell them directly to their supermarket chains. But then the 25% remaining of the sorting is less good quality tomatoes, which is then sold directly to the tomato paste factory. And when I look at the wholesaler, the value-adding activity that they do is again grading, but they grade, they have three different grades, and based on different grades they do, they send the produce to different markets. 30% grade C to the open market because it needs to be sold very quickly, 30% grade A to the supermarkets because this is the market where the higher income consumers goes the most, and 40% grade B goes to the retailer that can then sell directly to the consumers. So this was the second step that I tried to undertake. For the prices, I don't have the prices yet. I only know for now the price that the produce is bought by the farmers. Medium-scale farmers do sorting, and they start by selling to the supermarket warehouse for $0.30, and the lower grade goes to the trader. It's 80% of the production. That doesn't mean that it's not a good produce. It's just the grade is different. Goes to $0.15 to the graders. The steps in between are for me again to be explored to figure out what are the price transmissions based on all the value-adding activities that they are doing. But what I know at the end of the consumer is that the product is sold, the high quality grade one, to $3.95 per kilo, that is USD dollars, to high income consumers, to $2.50 to middle income consumers, to $1.50 to low income consumers. So now what I need to understand to elaborate further my value chain is the price is $1.50 here while it was sold at the farm gate at $0.30. What was the activities and what is the cost of each value adding activity, and what is the not the benefit but how do you call it?
Net value.
The net value of the product, and how much interest does the actor in the value chain put and sell it to the next actor in the value chain, and that it could reach to a market price that is 1.50. So this will be the next step that I will try to do. And then I will give a pause here so that we continue with the presentation, but then we will come back to this example to see how you can strategize based on the value chain that you just did. Thank you.
So after drawing your value chain linkages and having a subsector mapping, we are not done. The most important part is still coming. It's about what are the challenges for farmers, and most importantly, what are the opportunities for farmers and farmers organizations, and hence, what are the strategies to improve the revenues of farmers. We saw in the tomato example a difference of maybe tenfold price for consumers as compared to what farmers get at their farm. This is not fake, it's often a reality. We also showed the coffee case, it's maybe 100 times more. So it doesn't mean that farmers can earn 10 times more, but they can position themselves in such a way that they get more value. And that's the whole purpose of value chain analysis, and doing it also not only for farmers, but with farmers. Now, in this one, I don't know if you see it clearly. We don't have elaborate slides on challenges and opportunities, but we have quite elaborately giving you advice. So think of all possible challenges that farmers can face. Is it low production? Is it the high losses? Is it high cost of inputs? Is it the lack of knowledge of the market? Could they take up processing activities? What is their negotiation power? If farmers bulk their produce together, they have more to sell together, so maybe collective marketing could be an opportunity. So indeed, challenges, if you think about it, probably there are many, and here we make some suggestions what challenges could be, but every case is different. And linked to challenges, of course, are opportunities. And we always say in OPPO, a challenge is an opportunity, at least to solve it. So what we propose you to do is to really think with your mapping about the challenges first, and then to identify opportunities and to visualize them in your drawing, and also to list them in a flip chart.
So we propose that you make this flip chart. In red you put the challenges, and in green you put the opportunities. So have an overview that is like an agenda to your drawing. And the numbers can be also put in your drawing, so that you can relate the challenges and opportunities to the positions and the levels in your value chain map.
Ted just told you about what are the steps to strategizing based on the knowledge you get from the value chain analysis we did. He suggested to first reflect on what are the challenges and what are the opportunities that you see because of doing the analysis. Just want to show you an example. I didn't do the numbering like it is written in the guidance doc, but here I have, this is orange but it's red. So I have some challenges of high losses before transportation. I have challenges in supplying demand. There is a big demand, but the farmers are not yet able to supply the demand based on the different requirements of the different markets that we just saw here. Like we already saw that there were three different grades, A, B, C, and low production. Therefore, not being able to supply demand. The opportunities that I saw, which somehow also addresses the challenges that I just mentioned, is the different requirements. There are different markets, and if I'm a producer that produces and have different grades already, and if I sort them myself, that gives me the chance to already have three different price options for the different grading I did, so the value activities I did. Different markets, because of trying to undertake a value chain analysis, I have more insight about the different markets and what is done to reach these different markets by different actors. So this is an opportunity for me because I can reflect on it and see, okay, if I come together with this many farmers, we can supply this much volume, and then we can target this specific market that has this volume coming from different sources. Another opportunity I saw was demand from different grades again. Same example, different markets, different requirements. This is an opportunity for me because then I can do the grading and sorting myself. And for the sake of the exercise, normally what you could do to make it even more visualized is to have a number from each of them, and each number with the red and then green pen, you can write them in the different places where the challenge and the opportunity is, so that you see, based on, let's say, in one of the lines, on one of the value chains, you have many more opportunities than challenges. Then it can be strategic to take up, to put your effort, your initial effort, in that specific value chain because it already offers you a lot of opportunity. So that's the reasoning we have with the value chain analysis, then challenge and opportunity analysis to see how we can strategize. And you also have some guiding questions in this document. And we welcome you, since you still have the time until December, to send us your questions where there are places that you think it's not very clear, so that maybe we can even update the document for the future users that might want to undertake a value chain analysis. Here you go. It is possible to develop value chain analysis also in the Pacific, because our OPPO trainees, in a very short amount of time, were able to develop these value chains based on the knowledge they had at that time. And we will upload these tomorrow also for your information. You can check them and try to understand how they differ from your own value chains, because some of the commodities here might be your commodity. Thank you.